This is the first ever official photograph of a tank going into action. It shows a British Mark I tank at the Battle of Flers-Courcelette on the 15th of September 1916. In another photo taken on the same day, we see another tank. Both of these were hot, noisy, slow, and very unreliable. But they were both revolutionary for their time, the start of a long line of development that would change the face of warfare forever. But there is one difference between them. This tank is male, and this tank is female. Why?
Yeah, it is a bit strange.
That's Bryn Hammond, head of one of the curatorial teams at Imperial War Museums.
You'll notice these tanks didn't have a turret on top like tanks from the present day. Instead, the armament sat on each side of the tank in these things called sponsons. Each tank had a six-pounder naval gun and a machine gun in each one of them. But before they even went into action, concerns were raised about these vehicles that they might not be able to defend themselves against infantry attacks. So it was decided that half of the 150 tanks ordered would be equipped only with machine guns, two in each sponson, and the others would keep their big guns. The two types of vehicles were to work in pairs, one destroyer tank and one man-killing tank. The half armed with the six-pounder guns, which seemed more phallic, became known as male tanks, and their machine gun toting partners became female tanks.
Whether male or female, this newest weapon of warfare presented a whole new challenge for both sides. Terrifying to those who opposed them, they were also a complex problem for the side using them. The question of how best to use tanks would preoccupy their chief users, the British and French, for the remaining 2.5 years of war. How do you get infantry and tanks to work together? And that question brings us to something called anthropomorphism.
Right, so anthropomorphism is when you ascribe human characteristics to a non-human thing.
There are plenty of examples in history and mythology of warriors naming their weapons. Indeed, IWM has plenty of these in our collection. But why would you name a weapon? Why do we anthropomorphize things?
Oh, loads of reasons. We might want to anthropomorphize an object because it seems to have a human face or shape, or because it evidences illogical behavior. Or it may demonstrate human idiosyncrasies. It may be we want to establish a bond with it that's personal and possessive. It's mine, I named it. Or maybe we just want to befriend it.
We still see this practice today. We name our cars and our trucks. We ask our computers, why won't you work? And let's not even get started on Boaty McBoatface.
If we go back to the First World War, for example, British tank crews did this too. The names were very varied, from characters in classic mythology to execrable puns. But there were some rules. Tank names were usually expected to align with the initial letter by which their battalion was identified. 2nd Battalion was B, 8th Battalion was H, and so on. These names were actually very useful for accompanying infantry to report the tank's progress in action. Because tank soldiers chose the tank names themselves, they didn't always choose names that aligned with the tank's gender.
But these names were more than a bit of fun. They also helped demystify these brand new machines. Anthropomorphizing tanks helped soldiers understand something wholly new in the history of warfare.
A great example of this is the Battle of Amiens in August 1918. It was the most significant Allied combined arms offensive of the war, and the tank corps was deploying more tanks than ever before. The problem was the infantry, chiefly the Australians, despised tanks. Ever since a disaster at Bullecourt in April 1917, when the attacking Australian infantry got slaughtered, they were deeply suspicious of these mechanically unreliable beasts. Tanks drew German shellfire, and that got you killed.
The tank corps, who since that disaster had become far better trained and equipped, knew they had to win over these Australian doubters if they were to work together effectively. And so they embarked upon a charm offensive.
Well, alongside the formal training to show what the tanks could do, other more social activities were organised. Tank rides and large quantities of alcohol featured. But one battalion, the 15th, O, decided they'd also let their Australians name a few of the tanks.
Two of those names were Otazel and Udnadatta. One of them is a bad pun, hot as hell, and the other is the name of a small settlement on the edge of the Simpson Desert in South Australia, where daytime temperatures in January can easily go above 40 degrees Celsius.
What you have here are examples of tough men recognising the tank crew's lot. Inside a First World War tank, with the crew sharing the same compartment as the engine, it could indeed be as hot as hell. Effective cooperation requires mutual understanding. And here, the tank crews and their Australian infantry partners were finding just that.
When they finally went into battle together on the 8th of August 1918, the success they achieved along with Canadian, British and French forces was so significant that it was referred to by an opposing commander as the Black Day of the German Army. Going forward, the success at Amiens would make possible the subsequent series of war-winning attacks that led to Germany's final defeat in November 1918.
Anthropomorphism helps us identify with and understand non-human objects. By naming these tanks, some of these Australian troops were able to accept, even welcome tanks, and work with them to end the war with Germany. On this occasion, a name was far more than a name. It was a mark of respect and understanding. There's a lot of great tank names in the video, but I want to know, if you had a tank, what would you call it? Let me know in the comments below. Bad puns are always appreciated. Obviously, the museum's doors are shut at the moment, but we've still had loads of amazing stories that, like this one that we'd like to share with you. We need your support to continue doing this. So, after you've liked and subscribed, please consider donating to RWM. Thanks a lot.